Let me adjust the sound and make it louder since I'm not wearing the microphone next to my face. The Picture of Dorian Gray by Oscar Wilde. At this point of the novel, Dorian Gray is faced with something that is terrifying to him. He doesn't want to part with a painting. He doesn't want to give the painting to the painter, not even for a short period of time. He doesn't want the painter to even look at the painting. Why is that? Dorian is afraid that maybe it will be noticeable that his face is still young while the portrait is deteriorating. Not just like the canvas is getting holes in it or being in any way damaged by the elements. The painting appears to have been a painting of somebody older. Every day, the painting is aging. Harry, to whom I talked about it, laughed at me, but I did not mind it. When the picture was finished and I sat alone with it, I felt that I was right. Well, after a few days, the thing left my studio, and as long as I had got rid of it, the intolerable fascination of its presence. It seemed to me that I had been foolish in imagining that I had seen anything in it, more than you were extremely good-looking, and that I could paint. Even now, I cannot help feeling that it is a mistake to think that the passion one feels in creation is never really shown in the work one creates. Art is always more abstract than we fancy. Form and color tell us of form and color. That is all. It often seems to me that art conceals the artist far more completely than it ever reveals him. And so, when I got this offer from Paris, I determined to make your portrait the principal thing in my exhibition. It never occurred to me that you would refuse. I see now that you were right. The picture cannot be shown. You must not be angry with me, Dorian, for what I have told you. As I have said to Harry, once you are made to be worshipped. Dorian Gray drew a long breath. The color came back to his cheeks, and a smile played about his lips. The peril was over. He was safe for the time. Yet he could not help feeling infinite pity for the painter who had just made this strange confession to him, and wondered if he himself would ever be so dominated by the personality of a friend. Lord Henry had the charm of being very dangerous, but that was all. He was too clever and too cynical to be really fond of. Will there ever be someone who would fill him with a strange idolatry or idolatry? Was that one of the things that life had in store? It is extraordinary to me, Dorian, said Hallward, that you should have seen this in a portrait. Did you really see it? I saw something in it, he answered, something that seemed to me very curious. Well, you don't mind my looking at the thing now? Dorian shook his head. You must not ask me that, Basil. I cannot possibly let you stand in front of that picture. You will someday, surely. Never. Well, perhaps you're right. And now goodbye, Dorian. You have been the one person in my life who has really influenced my art. Whatever I have done that is good, I owe to you. You don't know what it cost me to tell you all that I have told you. My dear Basil, said Dorian, what have you told me? Simply that you felt that you admired me too much? That is not even a compliment. It was not intended as a compliment, it was a confession. Now that I have made it, something seems to have gone out of me. Perhaps one should never put one's worship into words. It was a very disappointing confession. Why, what did you expect, Dorian? You didn't see anything else in the picture, did you? There was nothing else to see. No, there is nothing else to see. Why do you ask? But you mustn't talk about worship. It is foolish. You and I are friends, Basil, and we must always remain so. You have got Harry, said the painter sadly. Oh, Harry, cried the lad, with a ripple of laughter. Harry spends his days in saying what is incredible, and his evenings in doing what is improbable. Just the sort of life I would like to lead. But still, I don't think I would go to Harry if I were in trouble. I would sooner go to you, Basil. You will sit to me again? Impossible. You spoil my life as an artist by refusing, Dorian. No man came across two ideal things. Few come across one. I can't explain it to you, Basil, but I must never sit to you again. There is something fatal about a portrait. It has a life of its own. I will come and have tea with you. That will be just as pleasant. Pleasanter for you, I'm afraid, murmured Hallward, regretfully. And now goodbye. I am sorry you won't let me look at the picture once again, but that can't be helped. I quite understand what you feel about it. As he left the room, Dorian smiled to himself. Poor Basil, how little he knew of the true reason, and how strange it was that, instead of having been forced to reveal his own secret, he had succeeded, almost by chance, in wresting a secret from his friend. How much that strange confession explained to him, the painter's absurd fits of jealousy, his wild devotion, his extravagant panegyrics, his curious reticences. He understood them all now, and he felt sorry. There seemed to him to be something tragic in a friendship so colored by romance. He sighed and touched the bell. The portrait must be hidden away at all costs. He could not run such a risk of discovery again. It had been mad of him to have allowed the thing to remain even for an hour in a room to which many of his friends had access. Dorian Gray decides now to completely put the painting away. This obsession that he has with the painting has something to do with the relationship between the painter and himself. They both gave a lot of themselves to the painting, and they both formed a relationship, and there is a hint in here, in this very passage. There seemed to him to be something tragic in a friendship so colored by romance. In this passage, we feel that there is sexual romantic tension between the two. So the homosexuality factor, which a lot of people, and we have to remember that in 1890, when this novel was published, it was not commonplace to talk about homosexuality. Nowadays there is a lot of taboo, there is a lot of prejudice, but back in 1890 it was way taboo to talk about homosexuality, to even hint it. So the nuances are, if you will, in Portuguese, nuances of homosexuality, of this relationship, the ambiguity of the relationship between the painter and Dorian Gray. Is it a friendship? Are they in love with each other? Is there sexual tension? This is hinted. It is not spoken out. It is not out there for everybody to see. You have to really pick up the subtleties of their conversations. And there is some passion involved in this relationship because they're both very passionate about the painting. The painting represents to Dorian that what he does not want in his life. He doesn't want to get old. The painting is going to get old. He's not going to. Like I talked about many times before, realismo fantástico. There is something going on here that is extraordinary. This just doesn't happen. If you take a picture of somebody, if you paint a picture of them, the picture will be the same 10 years from now. You might get the picture might get damaged, it might get broken, but the image itself won't get old. That is just common sense, logic. But what happens to this painting that is getting older as Dorian Gray stays young defies logic, defies common sense, and there is no plausible explanation given in any passage thus far about how this happened. It is just a reality that we are presented with, although it is extraordinary. So, realismo fantástico is something, some sort of phenomenon that takes place without a plausible explanation, without a logical explanation, without any sort of, it's not like the reader will know why this is happening. We just know that it is, and we accept it as a form of reality. That is part of literature. It is an aspect of literature that is explored in great lengths in certain areas. There are books where there are fairies, and there are books in which you see science fiction and all of that. But even in those circumstances, there are explanations. They build a machine in a science fiction novel where the machine is able to change people's faces or to create a clone. So there is an explanation. So that isn't quite realismo fantástico, which translated literally would be fantastic realism. In this situation here, it is just a phenomenon that happened and nobody has any clue of why it happened, but it is accepted as a reality. The only person who is aware of this happening right now is Dorian Gray. He knows the painting is getting older and he is staying young. Nobody else has seen the painting. He doesn't want anybody to see the painting. This encounter between the painter, between Basil Hallward and Dorian Gray, in which they discuss the nature of their relationship with the painting, they both express themselves in ways that they hadn't done before. Basil makes a confession to Dorian. This moment is one of the critical incidents in the novel. In earlier lectures about literature on this channel, I have talked about the differences between a short story and a novel. A short story has one critical incident, or it can also be described or called an activating circumstance. It has one of those. And as events unravel, there is either closure or perhaps an open ending in which you're left with your conclusions. In a novel, there are several different critical incidents, activating circumstances, if you will. And they are definitely, because there are more chapters, because of length, there is, of course, not just one possibility, but several possibilities of unraveling these different critical incidents or activating circumstances. Whereas in a short story, it is more concise. There is one basic activating circumstance that is the very core of the whole story. In a novel, there would be many. So we had first, perhaps one of the first activating circumstances in here was when the painting was finished. Later on, we hear about Sybil Vane and Dorian Gray. She's the object of his affection. And then all of a sudden, she is so distraught by losing him that she kills herself. That's another activating circumstance right there. And now the painting, he starts to notice that the painting is getting older and he doesn't want people to see it. There is another activating circumstance. And finally, now he really had this encounter with the painter, and they both discussed how they feel about the painting. And that passage that I just read, and I just gave you an example of the subtleties of homosexuality, of a hint of homosexuality between the two. We could say, we could argue, that Dorian Gray could be bisexual. He had a relationship with a woman, and this ambiguity here in the relationship with, between him and the painter, there is hints. Some people agree, some people disagree with what I'm going to say, but it is possible that he had encounters with men throughout the many years that he lived. Which brings us back to the autobiographical character of the novel. Is Dorian Gray somewhat an alter ego for Oscar Wilde? The displays of homosexuality perhaps are not as openly portrayed because of the times. This is 1890. The novel had to actually be rewritten, and some parts of it were toned down because it was not something that society was ready to receive at the time. This has been a presentation of literary analysis, a class in literature where you will learn about the elements of the narrative. The narrative here, the picture of Dorian Gray, it is an omniscient narrator who is not a part of the story. It is told by third person perspective. The narrator is not one character in the story. The narrator is a removed narrator, narrating the story in third person, but he is omniscient. An omniscient narrator knows it all, knows all that goes on, knows the perspective of Dorian Gray, knows the perspective of the painter, the perspective of all the characters and everything, omniscient, all-knowing. I also talked about the differences between a short story and a novel. There is a great degree of symbolism, and in past lectures I have talked about that. Today, in this passage, one of the most important things to remember, this is the end of chapter 9. The portrait must be hidden away at all costs. Now, Dorian Gray has come to terms with the realization that he really is not ready to share this with the world because realismo fantástico, let's keep that in mind, fantastic realism. This is a reality that is distorted. He doesn't know how people would react, and he doesn't have an explanation for it. We, the readers, as we read, we don't get an explanation for it either. So some aspects have been discussed today, and I will record more videos and continue reading. This is not just about reading a book out loud. It's much more than that. People might start watching a video like this, and they might, I was just reading a book out loud, I can do that. Any idiot can read a book out loud. But if you listen to everything I have to say once I put the book down and start explaining what's going on in the narrative, then you will get your literature class, your literary analysis, and you will understand as I dissect the novel. You will be able to understand it better and perhaps see it from a different perspective. I'll help you reading between the lines. Anybody can pick up a book and read, but some people won't absorb the knowledge or even understand the material. That's where the literature teacher comes in.